think ever since I was a little kid, I just have a lot of questions. I think it used to annoy my father, even though he's a researcher himself. But I always used to ask why. And I think as I got older and realized that I could systematically ask questions and get answers, that really motivated me and excited me. I didn't actually think that I was going to be a professor. And I realized that a lot of the things that I was the most interested in were questions that people hadn't really done a lot of research on. And so I decided to do a PhD. But then as I was doing a PhD, I realized that I was super excited about doing research too. As a biology undergrad, as I said, like, I was used to working in the lab, and that was a little isolating for me. But the social science part, I found really energizing. So just like healthcare, just like, you know, everything else, science and technology also reflect society. And because they reflect society, they reflect social inequities too. And so in thinking about how can we make sure that science and technology are equitable and just, it's sort of an avenue through which I can help to contribute more generally to questions of equity and justice. But I think it's really important in the area of science and technology, just because we tend to think that it's objective and outside of society, that makes it even more consequential, because those kinds of dimensions don't get challenged or don't get questioned. And so revealing how that happens in these scientific and technological systems becomes even more consequential. You know, whether it's that we wait for genetic testing. Today, obviously, we're totally influenced by whether or not we have a COVID vaccine. You know, nowadays, we're totally tied to our smartphones. We're increasingly contending with artificial intelligence, right? We're dealing with technology in all aspects of our lives. And kind of what inspired me in the beginning was really realizing that technology is not just more complicated, but that it tends to reflect society. So I would say my biggest research accomplishment is my most recent book, Patent Politics. I found that political context, history, really influenced these areas that you tend to think of as technical and straightforward, right? A patent you give if somebody's invented something, right? But it turns out it's way more complicated than that. It's a place that's deeply moral and political, and it contributed to my bigger research agenda, which is how can we make science and technology more equitable and just? Because there are important perspectives to be heard. I mean, you know, 50% of the population are girls and women, and if we want to develop science and technology that actually helps the lives of girls and women, then we need to have girls and women at the table. And so the question is, how do we change the structures, but also change even the ways of you know, deciding what's a good paper, or how papers are discussed, how papers are reviewed, right? How is research reviewed? Even in those areas, and here you can sense a theme, right? In those areas that seem like, oh, we created this approach to science because it was the best approach to science. Well, when we decided that that was the best approach to science, we had a pretty homogeneous group of people making that set of decisions. So maybe our peer review processes might look a little bit different and be a little less harsh, for example, if we engaged girls and women. But that doesn't mean that they're going to somehow be less or less rigorous. It just means that we might create different kinds of cultures that won't be as alienating for girls and women.